try to be discreet, but how about them Tigers? Yesterday, Coach Dabo said, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ that gives me strength. And it was no coincidence that 4 threw it to 13 for a national championship. So I'm happy about that. This morning, if you would, go ahead and stand your feet as we get ready to go to the Lord in worship and in prayer this morning. Had something on my mind. This week I was under the weather on Wednesday. And I don't know if those of you who are around the TV during the daytime when most folks is out and about, there ain't nothing on TV. And I'm laying there not feeling good, and I saw that the national championship was on. I said, yes, I'm going to watch this again. And I'm watching it, and I find myself just getting uptight. I find myself getting tensed. Oh, I'm feeling upset, you know. Oh, God, there goes that man again. There goes that man again. How is O.J. Howard open again? Oh, and I'm looking at the scoreboard, and I'm, oh, Jesus, what is going on? And it occurs to me, hey, dummy, I know the outcome. I know how this thing ends. Can I tell you, there's fewer things less important than the scoreboard when they still time on the clock. Come on, somebody. Somebody needs to understand what I'm trying to tell you. I'm trying to tell you, quit looking at the scoreboard. Quit hanging out like it's halftime and get in the game. Because listen to me, you're going to hurt one way or another. I'd rather hurt because I got in the game and gave everything I had. You're going to hurt one way or another. I want to hurt because I gave everything. I don't want to be laying on my deathbed one day to sit there and think of all and hurt because of what I could have, would have, should have done. Come on, somebody. The word of the Lord says this in Psalms chapter 33. The Lord looks from heaven and he sees all the sons of men. From the place of his dwelling, he looks on the inhabitants of the earth. He fashions their hearts individually. He considers all their works. Can I tell you, God knows your name. God knows you individually as a person. It says this though, no king is saved by the multitude of an army. A mighty man is not delivered by his strength. A horse is a vain hope for safety, neither shall it deliver any by its great strength. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his mercy. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. It's in his mercy that I have the ability to hope. Are y'all with me this morning? Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield, for our heart shall rejoice in him because we have trusted in his holy name. Let your mercy, O Lord, be upon us just as we hope in you. Quit looking at the scoreboard, and if you can't trust nothing else this morning, you can trust in his name. His name is a firm foundation. It is the name which is above every name. Moses said, who am I going to tell them sent me? He said, I am. I am that I am. I am what I am, all that you need. Are you able to do this for me? I am. Who is like the Lord? Nobody but I am. I am that I am. His name is faithful. His name is secure. You can trust in the name of the Lord. If you know what I'm talking about this morning, I want you to slip up your hand as we get ready to go in prayer. The Kennedy family this morning can rejoice because of the life that Brother Thea lived. That was the happiest funeral I've ever seen, because we have the knowledge that Brother Thea trusted in the name of the Lord. The Johnson family and the loss of a family member, the Q family, a special request for somebody who's needing discernment, wisdom, and peace. He is the Prince of Peace. And someone who's in an abusive marriage and just needs support and healing. If you would, let's slip up your hand. Let's go before the Lord this morning. Almighty God, there is none like you. Lord, we start off this service, Lord, with praise and worship for who you are. I thank you that your name is a strong tower, Lord. The righteous are able to run into it and be safe, Lord, because there is no name like your name. There's not even enough names to give us your full identity of who you are, Lord Jesus. You are our everything. You're like the air that we breathe. As the word says, like the deer pants for the water, Lord, we long, we thirst for you, because there's nothing that can quench our thirst like you. You are a spring of eternal hope. You are the hope of our salvation. You are the hope for a better tomorrow. You are the courage and the strength in our today. Lord, we magnify you. Let us exalt your name in your house this morning. Church, if you would lift your hand and begin to bless his holy name. Lord, we magnify you. There is none like you, Lord. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the name. Worthy is the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Lord, we pray your healing on these situations and your direction, your wisdom, your peace, and your discernment, Lord. The steps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord, and we are made righteous by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We magnify you in this place. We glorify you in this place. You alone deserve all the praise. Lord, I thank you. Today is a good day. It's a good day. It's a beautiful day. Today is the day you've made, and we are going to rejoice and be glad in it. Worthy is your name. You did a good job. Oh, Lord, you did a good job. In Jesus' holy name. In Jesus' name. Worship the Lord.
Amen. Do you come to glorify the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. We're going to let's tell him just open up the heavens for us today. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. You know, one thing that was said that I really like, he said, let the light that shines in you be brighter than the light that shines on you. Amen. So let's let the glory of the Lord and his light shine out on us so that people can see the Lord and see him magnified. Amen.
We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here.
He's the reason.
You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, oh mighty river flowing from your heart. Day we gather in your name, calling out to you.
That's it, your glory.
Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth.
You're the reason.
You're the reason we're here.
Oh yes, you are.
You're the reason we're singing.
Come on, sing it out.
Open up the heavens, we want to see. Open up the floodgates, oh mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our brain.
Open up the heavens,
open up the heavens,
we want to see,
we want to see,
yes.
Open up the floodgates,
oh
mighty river flowing from your heart. Your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes.
You're the reason.
You're the reason.
The only reason. Yes.
You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates.
show us your glory, Lord. That's it, come on, tell him, say.
Show us your glory.
Show us your power.
Show us your power.
Show us your glory.
Show us your glory, Lord.
That's it, come on. Come on, tell him today, say it, say it.
Show us your glory.
Show us your power.
Show us your glory, Lord.
Right, come on, say it.
Show us your glory.
Show us your power.
Show us your power.
Today.
Yes, Lord.
We believe in the name of Jesus. He's a mighty God, a conqueror, an ever friend. Come on, he's a friend when you don't have a friend. He's peace when you don't have any peace. He's comfort when you can't find it, no matter where you look. That's my God. I believe in the name of Jesus. I don't believe in Muhammad or Buddha or any of these other people, because you know what? Jesus is the only one that I know that rose from the dead. I believe.
You're my refuge when I'm weary. You're the shelter for my soul. The healer when I'm broken. You're the grace that makes me whole. Oh, you're the song of my salvation, the rescue of my heart, and I believe you're everything you say you are.
Stolen in the garden.
Everything we need, Jesus. speak your name right now. We speak your name. We call on the name of Jesus. We call on the name of Jesus. Right now, you need to call on his name. Reach to him. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. You right now. We thank you, Lord God, that there's power in your name. We reach to you, Lord God, right now. We reached out to you, Lord God. There's no strength anywhere unless it comes from you. There's no power unless it comes from you. Lord, there's no peace unless it comes from you. There's no healing unless it comes from you. It's only in the name of Jesus. Only through his stripes. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, to come to my rescue.
Lord, capture me.
Thinking about that song, I Need You, Jesus. I was thinking about that song, I Need You, Jesus. I need you to come to my rescue. And how back in John chapter 11, where Martha and Mary sent word to Jesus that their brother was sick. There's something in studying. I was used that yesterday at the funeral for Thea Kennedy. And studying that, guys, I found something interesting. Where Lazarus was and where Jesus was about a two-day trip. The scripture said Jesus tarried 2 days and then he went back or went there. So that means that at the time the messenger told Jesus about Lazarus, he was already dead. And Jesus knew. As a matter of fact, he told his disciples, Lazarus is asleep, he's dead. Jesus knew he had died. So he didn't get in a hurry. He stayed 2 more days. Because to Jesus, it was just as easy to raise a man dead 1 day or 1 minute or 1 year. Because nothing is too dead for him. Nothing is too far gone for him. So if he hadn't shown up when you think he ought to show up, that's because it's no big thing to him. He can fix it when he shows up. I need you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. Will you bow your head with me just for a minute in this place? Because, come on, pastors, and get ready. We're going to pray for some people in this house who are facing some things that look too big for us to face. I'm starting a series today on facing the giants. Everybody will face giants in their life. Every one of us, everybody that's a child of God or not, you're going to face giants in your life. And you've got to be prepared to face those giants. But when it's too big for you, it's never too big for your God. When it's too much for you, it's never too much for your God. Amen? Somebody say, He can do it. This morning while we're in here, if you're in this place and you're going through something and the world says it's dead, it's over, it's too far gone, it's too late, but you believe that your Jesus can come on the scene and turn things around, whether it's an hour, a day, a week, a month, a year, or a decade, Jesus said, it's no problem for me. I'm not in any hurry. I can fix it when I get there. Well, we're in the presence of a holy God this morning. And I wonder this morning, if you're in this place and you're facing something and you want to just say, you know what, Pastor, I want to make sure I'm facing this with Jesus. Will you slip your hand up and put it right back down? Come on, anybody in the house? I'm facing some things and I want to make sure I'm facing this with Jesus. I want to make sure I'm going through this with Him. If you're here and you don't know that you know Him, you're not sure that God is with you and God is working these things. He said, all things work together for good of them who love the Lord and are called for His purpose. So you're going through some things and you're not sure that you can do it. You're not sure things are where they ought to be with the Lord. Now will you take another step and come down while everybody, no one's looking around, nobody's going to embarrass you, but will you take your step and come down and stand with one of these pastors, one of these prayer partners, and let them pray with you and let them just seek the Lord with you over this thing. We're going to sing a little more. We're going to worship a little more, but come on, step out and come down and say, you know what, I want to make sure what I'm going through that Jesus is going to show up. He's going to show up not on my time, but on His time. He's going to be here not on my time, but on His time. He's going to do a work and not when I think He should, but when He thinks He should. Come on. There's some more of you. Step out and come down and stand with one of these pastors. If you raise your hand, this is the time and the place to let God do the work. The time and the place to let God do the work. Come on. I need you, Jesus. Come to my rescue. I need you, Jesus. Come to my rescue. And I'll follow you. I'll walk with you. I'll be with you. I'll stand with you. I'll work with you. I need you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. Come on. There's some more. Come and ask Him. God loves it when we ask Him for help. He loves it. He's not impressed with our independence. He's impressed with our dependence on Him. Hallelujah. He's impressed when we call upon Him. He's impressed when we need Him. He's impressed when we ask Him for His help. I need you, Jesus. Come to my rescue. I need you, Lord. Come to my rescue. I need you, Father. In the name of Jesus, come to my rescue. Hallelujah. Do it, Lord, do it, Lord, do it, Lord. I need you, Jesus. I need you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on now, while these are praying, while they're in the altar praying, will you pray with us? Everybody else, my Father in heaven, I need you. I need you in my life. I need you to come in and turn things around. Wash me. Cleanse me. Make me new. Make me your child, and I'll make you my God. I receive your gift of eternal life in Jesus' name. If you believe he answers that prayer, come on, give him praise in this house. Hallelujah to God. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for your gift today. Hallelujah. We give you praise. Come on, sing a little bit more of that.
Hallelujah. I need you, Jesus.
Yeah.
To come to my rescue.
Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Yeah.
Where else can I go?
Hallelujah. Yeah. Come on.
No other name by
which
I am saved.
Yeah.
Oh, capture me with grace. Jesus, to come to my rescue.
Where else can I go?
Where else can I go?
There's no other name.
There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace. I will follow.
Hallelujah. Come on, yeah, I'll follow you, Lord.
Yes, Lord, we'll follow you.
I'll follow you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody just give him a great big hand of praise in this house. Come on, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Will you turn around to one or two people and tell them God's an awful good God? Come on, tell somebody, God is a good God. God's a good God. God is a good God. Amen. We're so glad to have you in the house. So glad to have the Spirit of the Lord in the house. And we just thank God. If you're a visitor this morning, we welcome you to your Father's house. Just pull up to the table and eat all you can eat. And we're just going to worship and serve the Lord. We have any first time or any visitors in the house, will you hold your hand up? We want to give you a visitor packet. And if you'll turn that or fill that visitor card out and turn it in, we have a gift for you at the Next Step Center. Any visitors this morning? Any visitors? Amen. Well, we're glad to have the home, folks. Hallelujah. Glad to have a home, folks. Praise the Lord. Yeah, anything you need to know, you can go online or go to the Next Step Center, and they'll answer your questions. We have new members class coming up in a couple of weeks. We've got a lot of things going on. WOW starting back up. Appreciate that. Thank God for you. Has he blessed anybody in the house? You can't outgive God. And this is our year of promise. And one of the promises he made is in Malachi chapter 3 when he said, try me and see if I'll not open the windows of heaven and pour you out such a blessing there'll not be room enough to contain it. And your fruit will not wither on the vine or will it rot in the field. He said, I'm going to make what you put your hands to successful. You believe God's going to keep his promise? Amen. Well, we're going to give you a chance to invest in that. Come on, ushers, and let's get ready to receive. What we like to do is let you come up and bring your offering and then just greet and talk to some of the greatest people on the face of God's green earth. Well, we got one person that knows they are. I said, you're in a room full of some of the greatest people on God's earth right in this house. Amen? Look at somebody and tell him he's talking about you. Go ahead and stand up. Get your offering out and hold it up. Come on, we got to say this like we mean it, like we believe it. This is my offering. I give it to God. I'm expecting. I'm believing. He said he would. He will. For me. If you believe it, shout yes. Now bring your offering and give and love on some of these folks in this house.
see with me how great is our God. Come on, stand your feet just one more time. How great is our God. Well, help me say it, say it. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Oh yeah, come on, tell him, sing it again, tell him. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God.
Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light.
Darkness tries to hide,
darkness tries to hide.
It trembles,
it trembles at his voice.
Come on, one more time, just sing it to him. Lift your voice and your hands, say,
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
Come on, tell him, say,
how great. Age to age he stands.
How many of you know time is in his hands?
Time is in his hands.
Alpha and the Omega.
Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end.
Oh, yes.
The Godhead three in one.
By the Spirit, Son.
By the Spirit, Son.
No, he's the Lion.
The Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb.
See
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
Well, that sounds good. Come on. Come on, let me hear you say it.
How great is our God.
That's it, declare it.
Sing with me how great.
He's great, divine.
Our God. Oh, we'll see how great.
That's it.
How great is our God.
All right, one more time for real. Here we go, one more time.
How great.
Oh, come on, somebody give him a shout of praise. How great is our God today? How great is our God? Hallelujah. I just feel the presence of the Lord in this house so wonderfully and so mightily. I don't want to get in a hurry if that's all right. They gave it to me a little early anyway, so. How great is our God? How great is our God? He's great. He's mighty and he's great. How great is our God? is our God. Hallelujah. Yeah. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great
is our God.
Oh, we'll see how great. How great
is our God.
Do it again, Dana. Come on. Sing it again. Sing it, church. Tell him. Oh, how great
is our God.
Sing the Lord. How great
is our God.
So can see how great
is our God.
Everything that God does, he does for the glory of his name. He doesn't do it to glorify John Smith or Word of Life or you. He does it to glorify his name. Jesus said about Lazarus, this sickness is not to glorify death, but to the glory of God the Father. Can I tell you something? Whatever you're going through, if you'll just hang on and trust God, it's going to turn out to the glory of God the Father. How great is our God? That's all he wants you to do, is tell everything and everyone you know, how great is our God? Come on, sing it again, Dana.
How great.
Hallelujah.
Is our God.
Come on and sing with me. How great
is our God.
Let all the world see how great.
How great.
Sing it to the Lord.
How great is our God.
Oh, sing how great
is our God.
Oh, we'll see how great
is our God.
Woo! Sandal on my side. Hallelujah. Hallelujah! 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 Come on, somebody just praise him in your own word, in your own way. Hallelujah! Glory to your name, O Lord. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. How great you are, Lord. Woo! Do it one more time and then we'll quit. One more time and we'll quit. Hallelujah.
Is our God.
Sing.
Oh, see how great.
How great
is our God.
How great. How great
is our God.
Oh, we'll see how great. Oh, how great
is our God.
Oh, yeah. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Rapha, my healer, Jehovah Nissi, my banner. Oh, you are great, O Lord, and great is your name. Hallowed be thy name. Hallowed be thy name. Hallowed be thy name today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallowed be thy name, O God. Yeah. Holy is your name, O God. Mighty is your name, O God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How great is your name, O Lord? Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Wow. What a great year we're starting out. Amen. What an awesome year we're starting out. Let the Holy Spirit just come and do it. Amen. One day I don't have a towel up here. See, hallelujah. Well, you may be seated in his presence. Glory to God. Thank you so much for your worship and your praise. Thank you so much for being here today. Thank God. We had Christmas, then we had New Year's, and then we had snow. So hopefully today, we just got to come to church. Those of you who are not from South Carolina, welcome to the state where last Friday we were waiting on snow. This Friday we're going in t-shirt and shorts and sweating. And if you don't like the weather in South Carolina, give it 24 hours. Scott, you are my friend. Thank you, brother. Phew, because I got a feeling they're going to bring it out of me. I want to look at 1 Samuel. I'm going to start a series today on facing the giants because I don't know. How many of you have done the fast with us before? We got one more week. We have one more week on the fast. And thank God that whoever named it a fast should be whipped because it's a slow. It's not a fast. But every year that we do the fast here at the church, the first 21 days of the year, things start happening. Good things and not so good things. Because when God goes to blessing, the enemy tries to distract you from what God's wanting to do, and he tries to bring things into your life to distract you from the blessings that God wants to give. And so this year, a year of promise, he's going to send some giants in your way to impede your progress, to stop your progress to where God's wanting to take you. So I just felt like God wanted me to step into this talk a couple of weeks. He sent me, very first of the year, he sent me to this scripture in 1 Samuel about David and Goliath and sent me into that. And so I said, well, Lord, you have to show me. And so we just started taking it bit by bit. Look at 1 Samuel 17 and verse 3. The Philistines stood on the mountain on one side. The Philistines now were the natural born enemies of the people of God, the Israeli people, the Hebrew people. And their existence is in the Old Testament. The Philistines are constantly in a struggle. It's much like the world today, evil versus good. Satan versus God. And so the Philistines stood on a mountain on one side. Israel stood on a mountain on the other side with a valley between them. You had good and bad. A champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Now, that's anywhere from about 9 foot 6 inches to 12, 13 feet tall. We're not sure exactly about the different people have different, but he's a big dude. He didn't wear a 13 shoe. He wore a 30 shoe. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and it was and was armed with a coat of mail. It was like scales of metal or hard leather on his coat. A coat of mail. The weight of the coat was about 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had a bronze armor on his legs and a bronze javelin between his shoulders. The staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam. It was iron spearhead that weighed 600 shekels, which is about his helmet weighed about 30 pounds. His spear, the head of his spear, weighed close to 100 pounds. He was a big dude. And his shield bearer went before him. Then he stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, "Why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man." Somebody say a man or a woman. A person, if you will, for yourselves and let him come down to me. If we're not careful, we will get so caught up in the literal rendering and reading of the Bible that we miss the spiritual context. And here's the thing about the spiritual context of the Bible. It can mean one, spiritually, it can mean to us one thing today and something different tomorrow. Are you saying the Bible changes? I said, no, I'm not. I'm saying our circumstances change. And I have found that I've read a scripture and be going through one thing, and what I found in that scripture, what it spoke to me, dealt with what I was doing in 2003. It dealt with that, and then go back and read it in 2006, and it dealt with what I was going through then, and then read it at 20 years old, and it dealt with what I was going through at 20 years old, and then 30 years old, and 40 years old, and because the Word of God is more spiritual than literal. Although I do know that there was a boy named David, a young man, a man named David, who was the king of Israel. I know there was a giant named Goliath, and it is a literal story that is very true, but it is more than that. The Word of God is kind of like a crossword puzzle. Across the surface, it can tell you what it tells you, but then it can tell you something else this way and something else this way, and because it speaks spiritually to where we are. Are you with me? So we can't just read through these stories, as historic facts and stories. We have to understand, because if we do that, if we just take it only literally, not many of us plan on facing a giant this week. Literally. Not many of us plan on being thrown into a lion's den this week. But many of us will face spiritual giants, and many of us will walk into some spiritual lion's dens. Not many of us are worried about being swallowed by a great fish this week. Bo's praying for that. But the spiritual context of the story about the giants, things that impede our progress, things that stop us, things that strike fear into us, that make us stop claiming the ground that we're claiming. I'll be honest with you, there's times, turn me down just a little bit in the house, there are times in my walk with God that there are things that happen, and I say, you know what, I don't want to fast anymore. This fast is stirring up devils. It's like when Paul took the wood and threw on the fire and the serpent came out of the fire. It stirs up demons and it stirs up devils and it makes the devil mad. And there's times when I say, you know what? I don't know if it's worth it going through this fast. But then you have to say, you know what? It is worth it. The enemy is just sending out giants to try to stop me from taking spiritual territory. But if we look at this story as we read it, Goliath didn't hurt one soldier. He didn't fire an arrow. He didn't fire a shot. He didn't swing his sword. All he did was stepped out from the crowd, stood in front of God's people, and blasphemed God and made fun of them. And his words and his size struck fear in the hearts of God's people that they stopped their progress. I'm here to tell the devil, I ain't scared no more. Come on, didn't you watch Home Alone again? We got to watch Home Alone every year. And remember when the little Macaulay Culkin goes outside, opens the door, he goes outside and tells the bad guys, hey, I ain't scared no more. Well, somebody needs to walk out your front door and holler at the devil, say, look here, devil, I'm not scared anymore. You need to stand up in the house of God and say, devil, I'm not backing up, backing down, backing away. I'm not scared anymore. That's what David did. Maybe we could have titled this Home Alone. He was there stepping out from everybody else. And like the book or the movie or whatever you've seen about facing the giants. Everyone. Somebody say everyone. Everyone will face giants. Everyone will come into problems, into situations, things that are way bigger than you are, things in our life that we'll feel like a little 13 to 16 year old boy standing up against a 9 to 12 foot man, war machine. We'll feel so overwhelmed in some of the things that come into our life. But what we have to understand, whatever it is, you may not be big enough, but your God is bigger than enough. Amen. It's bigger than enough. So we have to, but here's what I've got to get across to you today, because the entire Israeli army, the whole army, David's brothers, Saul, who was head and shoulders above everybody else, he was a pretty good giant himself. All of those great men of war who had killed and who had maimed and who had fought and bled and gone through all that, they all faced the same giant. Get me, if you don't hear anything else I say, you got to say this. Because everybody faces giants, but not everybody defeats giants. Everybody has huge problems. Everybody every once in a while comes up against things that they feel inadequate and they feel unable to do or handle or deal with. And not everybody defeats the giants. There was a whole army of men sitting up there polishing their armor and sharpening their swords and talking about last year's battle. Oh, there's plenty of them sitting around talking about, boy, do you remember back in 1973? But it's not 1973 anymore. It's not even 19 anymore. Now I'm having to get used to writing 2017. It's not enough to sit around and brag about the conquerings and the things we used to do and the battles we used to win. It's not even enough to sit around and sharpen our swords and polish our armor and look like we're going to battle. Because there's a lot of churches, they've got their armor polished and their swords sharp, and they know how to have church, baby. They know when to sing, when to stand up, when to sit down, when to, they know how to do it all. They know how to move and motivate and generate and manipulate. But ain't nobody killing no giants. They look like an army. They sound like an army. They even smell like an army. But ain't nobody facing no giants. Are you with me? So the Lord took me back to this. He said, I want you to tell the people that, yes, in 2017, you're going to come up against some giants, but you better be prepared if you're going to be a giant killer. If you want to be the person who defeats the giants, you got to be prepared. Let me go ahead and get on. Let's go to what I was talking about just now. Play and dress up. Look at 1 Samuel 17 and 2. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together, and they encamped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. Here they were, one army on the other, and all the people, every morning, I just can't fathom this, every morning, all the people, of the soldiers of Israel, every morning, guys, they got up, they got put on their helmet, put on their armor, got their sword, got their shield, got their arrows, whatever it was, their weapon of choice, and they all went out and stood like something was about to happen, and they stood, and they stood, and they stood, and they looked, and they gazed, and they put on their game face, and they stood all day long. And at nighttime, they went back to the tent and took off their helmet and took off their armor, laid down their sword, laid down their shield, laid down their bow and arrow, and went to bed no further than they were the day before. And we've got too many people content to look like Christians. Come on, you know, they're not here today, but you know who I'm talking about. Every Sunday morning, they get up and put on their Sunday clothes and Sunday blue jeans and Sunday Converses, and they get up and they get their Bible. They got their Bible. Bless God, I got my Bible. It had never been opened, but I got my Bible, and I got my Sunday clothes, and I go to church, and I got my chair, and don't you dare sit in my chair, because that's my chair, and I sit in my chair, and I know when to stand, and I know when to sit. They know all about it. Arrayed for battle, but nobody's fighting. Dress for battle and nobody's fine. I can quote John 3:16 and the 23rd Psalm and two or three others. I know how to use my sword. I just don't use it. Is this okay today? They were arrayed. They were playing dress up instead of fighting. There's a war taking place in the spirit world, and the good side is lined up against the bad side. Is there anybody at Word of Life this morning who's willing to face some giants and take them down for God? You've got to be willing to face the giant. You've got to be willing to walk out and not sit along with everybody else and wait for somebody to come along who's going to do it. God is looking for a man and a woman. That's what the giant said. Send me a man. God may be waiting on you to step up into your place before he brings a victory like no other victory. Goliath asked a question. He stood and cried out to the armies in verse 8, 1 Samuel 17 and 8. He stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And you the servants of Saul? Choose you a man for yourself and let him come down and to me. Why are we here? That song we sung a while ago. Why are we here? Why did you come? Why are you in this place? Are you here to pay your eternal fire insurance? Are you here so God won't be upset with you to maybe get a gold star from God to have a good week? That's not why we're here.
We're here, number one, to glorify how great is your God, oh God. We're here to remind ourselves and remind, look at somebody, tell them your God is a great God. Come on, tell somebody, stir up somebody. We're here, first of all, to tell them our God is a great God. Our God is a mighty God. And second thing we're here to do is tell the devil, you're not getting my house. You're not getting my family. You're not getting my job. You're not getting my health. You're not getting my home. It's not enough to be religious. You need to get your armor on and face your devil. It's not enough to talk time my. It's not enough to look like it. You need to be it. Religious folk, but not willing to fight. Well, I can't fast. I get hungry. Well, give up the TV. Oh, Jesus. What am I going to do? I don't know. How I'll read the Bible? Pray? I can't pray. I can't tell people about the Lord. I can't. Can't, never could do nothing. My third grade teacher drilled that in my head. She would not let you say you couldn't do anything. Don't tell me what you can't do. Tell me how you're going to figure out how to do it. And I'm going to tell you something. You're no weaker. You're no more unqualified than any other child of God. We all face giants, and we all feel like little David against that giant. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Are you willing to fight? So many people like to run when it gets hard. They like to run from giants. And they wonder why they never get anywhere. You're getting somewhere back where you were 2 years ago. I ain't going back. That's right, I said ain't. Because the devil understands my workplace English. David did not have the traditional weapons or the traditional armor of all the other soldiers. Look at 1 Samuel 17:38. So Saul clothed David with his armor. And he put a bronze helmet on his head. And he clothed him with a coat of mail. And David fastened his sword to his armor and tried to walk. For he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these, for I have not tested them. So David took them off. Here, now you got to understand, David was 13 to 16 years of age. He was a little shepherd boy. Saul was head and shoulders above every other man. And Saul was like 6'6", and he tried to put his armor on this little boy. So David's peeping out from under the helmet, got the breastplate bumping on his knees, thinking, if I go out here trying to be him, the devil's going to have me for lunch. But see, Saul said, if he wears my armor, maybe the armies will think it's me that kills a giant. Too many people wanting credit for what God does. Too many people, they don't want you to get ahead, because if you get ahead, it's going to make them look bad. So you better watch out or they'll sabotage you so you don't look better than them. Oh, I'm preaching today. And so David said, I can't be Saul. I can't depend on Saul's armor. I can't expect somebody else to cover me with their prayer. I can't fight giants. I can't fight devils and demons because somebody else is praying. If I'm going to fight him, I've got to fight him with my own weapons. Oh, I'm preaching now. We got too many people depending on mama and them to carry us through. You better forget about mama and them. I'll never forget back in 1988, my grandma Smith passed away, and my grandma, or she passed away actually in 89, but she passed away, and I remember when she used to come stay with us, and you've heard me tell it. I remember through the night, you'd come in, she'd be praying, wake up in the middle of the night, you'd hear her, I don't know how she prayed all night, but she'd be in there praying. I remember getting so aggravated. Why don't she hush and go to sleep? She'd pray all night. And then when she passed away, and that same year, Pastor Jack Hodges, who pastored this church when we came to be here, he passed away. But I can remember going to his house to visit him, and he'd be laying in his sick bed, hardly able to breathe. But I'd hear him calling my name and other people's name out, laying in the bed. And that year, both of them died. I said, God, what am I going to do? My grandmother's not praying for me now. My Pastor Hodges is not praying for me now. What am I going to do? And God said, how about start praying? you can't go to battle with somebody else's armor on. I'm going to tell you something else. A lot of people try to put their traditional armor on you. God's not looking for traditional folks anymore. No. The traditional mindset's out the window. I've been doing this a long time. Been doing this here over 30 years. And things we did and things that used to be ain't no more. God's not using the traditional people. You don't even have to have a tie to be anointed these days. You can be anointed in blue jeans and tennis shoes or cowboy boots. You can be anointed in a pair of shorts and a t-shirt and flip-flops. God's not looking for the same old anymore. He's looking for some David who'll step out and say, I don't need to look like you want me to look. I need to look like God made me. Religious protocol and religious traditions and all those things, they don't mean anything to God. He's looking for a willing vessel. Number two, it's not who you think. Look at 1 Samuel 16 and 10. Thus Jesse made, now this is when God told Samuel, he said, I'm through with Saul. He won't listen to me. He's full of pride. Go down to Jesse's house, and there I'm going to anoint a king. So then, this is where we pick up in 1 Samuel 16, 10. Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. All of his impressive sons, Eliab and Abinadab and Nadab and the other Dabs came up, and none of them were anointed. All seven sons came up big. You know, I was down talking to my daughter and son-in-law's pastor down at the beach, and I mean, he's about 6'4" and got perfect salt and pepper hair, and got one of those Pepsodent smiles and a tan, and just, I hate him. I mean, I looked at him and I wanted to go to his church. No, I didn't hate him. He's a great guy, great pastor, great guy, but he just is too pretty. And I said, I mean, I got a good looking mom and dad, but they didn't give me those jeans. And so Jesse brings up his oldest son, and he's a warrior, and he's a strapping man, and he steps up, and God said, hadn't chosen this. The next son comes, hadn't chosen this. All seven sons. And notice the verbiage, even in the New American Standard or the New King James, it says, neither has the Lord, or the Lord has not chosen these. And he said, when he talked about it, neither has the Lord chosen this. And I said, Lord, you know, are you calling them a thing? He said, no, I'm talking about the things that Samuel was looking at. Samuel said, oh man, he's a big, tall, impressive, hadn't chosen these. Oh man, they got this and they got that going for him. Pastor Philip, come up and got all that hair. Pastor Philip was talking about in the early service about when he gets to heaven, he's going to have hair. Neither has the Lord chosen this. Don't have to have hair to be anointed. You don't have to have all those things. God don't need those things. He don't need the things that we look at and say, that must be God's anointed. He's talented. He's smart. He's got plenty of teeth. He's good looking. But that's not what God needs. Well, do you have any other children? Well, I got one more son. He's the runt. He's the baby. Because see, here's the problem with us. We're going to find one of these guys that looks good, and we're going to promote him and say, this has got to be it. Oh, he's got to be it. See, man promotes and celebrates the talents and the looks and all those things. And how many people have we loved their talents and their abilities and they impress us, and we put them up on a pedestal only to watch them fall off? And then we're like, well, I knew that was too good to be true. Well, then why did we put them up there? Men will promote. And we've seen too many people in the Christian world, because they had these things, people flocked to them and put them on a pedestal, and then they don't stay there because, well, Martin Luther King, tomorrow's Martin Luther King, a celebration of his birthday, or we're recognizing his birthday. Martin Luther King said it like this, one day I'll live in a country where my children will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. Can I tell you something? We've got to stop judging people by what we see. Get to know these people and know what they are. It doesn't matter the color of their skin. It doesn't matter their socioeconomical place in the society. What's in your character? What's in your heart? We've got to get to know these people. Anybody can be good an hour a week. The devil goes to church an hour a week. What's in your character? What the God has not chosen these. He's chosen the willing vessel. Is this all right today? Amen. We promote people higher than their character can hold them, and then we like to watch them come crashing down. The story of Jesus' birth is much like this. The wise men went looking for Jesus, and where did they go? They went to Herod's palace. We saw, where is he that is born, King of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east, and we've come to worship him. He's the king. He must be in the palace. Eat wrong. He's not in the palace. He's not in the mansion. He's not in, no, no, guess where he's at? He's out there in the barn, in the stable, in the feed trough, in the rags. And I'm here to tell you, you better be aware of who you're being good to. Be aware of who you're acknowledging. Because it's not necessarily coming from the person riding in the big car flashing all the money. It's coming from the one in the barn, in the stable, in the rags. Are you with me? Little David, he was the one. He didn't have all the, and they know they didn't accept Jesus. Jesus didn't come with a big army, and they didn't even to his death, never did recognize him because he wasn't what they were expecting. Number three, it was the busy son. Look at 1 Samuel 16 and 11. Samuel said to Jesse, are these all your children? And he said, well, there remains the youngest. And behold, he's tending the sheep. Then Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes. Now, let me stop right here and tell you what, and it's not known for sure, but here's what is traditionally believed about David. The reason when Jesse brought all seven sons in and didn't bring David in is because David wasn't like the other boys. See, all the other boys had mothers, the same mothers, and all the other boys, but it is believed that David was actually the result of an affair with Jesse. Isn't that funny how things passed down from Jesse to David to Solomon? And so Jesse wasn't real proud of David because David was a mistake. And so he left him out in the fields with the sheep because he was not like the other boys. I'm glad when man makes me a mistake, God makes me right again. Illegitimate or not, I told y'all, when my daddy found out my mom was pregnant with me, he didn't speak to her for 9 months. I was a mistake, but I was the best mistake they ever made. I was not a mistake. I was planned by God before my daddy met my mama. Before Roy met Bertha or Arnold met Jesse. That's my grandparents. I was planned by God. You are not a mistake. Your life is not a mistake. You are planned by God, and he's got a plan for you, and he knows where you are. Look at somebody and tell him God knows where you are. So send and bring him, for we will not sit down to eat till he comes. That'll get you in a hurry, won't it? Especially during a fast. Hey, we're not going to eat till David gets here. Get down there and get that boy and get him back now. I haven't had anything to eat all day. I mean, get him here now. He said, we're not going to sit down and eat till he comes. So he sent and brought him in. Now, he was ruddy, beautiful eyes, handsome appearance. And the Lord said, arise and anoint him, for this is he. And Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. And Samuel arose and went to Ramah. all the other sons sitting around waiting on promotion. Don't you love those people? Don't you love them, Dina? They come to Word of Life looking for a microphone and a stage. I want to preach. Well, I'm not going to stay there because they won't let me. They won't let me do my ministry. And no man in flesh and blood and bone can stop you from doing your ministry. Well, they just won't let me. They will. Oh, take over? No, we won't. Take charge? No. Listen, I've been here 33 years, almost 34 years. When you pull 34 years, I might let you take over. Right now, the Holy Ghost is in charge, and I'm doing what He tells me. People wait, setting up, waiting to be discovered, waiting to be discovered, waiting for somebody to tell them how great they are and realize how great they are, full of their own importance. Anoint me, anoint me, anoint me. Neither have I chosen this. And so they bring David in. See, let me get back to, because I'm having too much fun with that. A lot of people are like the prodigal son. Father, give me what you owe me, because I'm talented and I've got it all together and I've done this and I've been there. I start worried when people tell you about the last 10 churches they've worked in. I'm like, 10 churches? Yes, sir, I've been working in 10 churches the last 3 years. Luke 15 and 12, the younger son said to the father, give me that portion of goods that falls that is owed to me. So he delivered him his livelihood. I don't want to serve. I want my stuff. I don't want to have to sit out there with a bunch of ruddy, snot-nosed kids. I want to be on the stage. Boy, it's quiet up in this church now, isn't it? Put up Christmas. I'm not anointed to put up Christmas decorations. I'm anointed to sing. I'm not anointed to stand out there and shake people's hands coming in the door. I'm anointed to teach and to preach. If you don't care about people, you don't teach and preach at Word of Life. Because it's not enough to love preaching and singing and teaching. It's not enough to love ministry. You've got to love people to succeed at doing what you do. And let me tell you, you don't stay 33 years in some place unless you love people. Ask Jesus. No sacrifice. No. I want to start out at the top. I remember hearing one pastor, they were talking about a pastor had failed morally and he was trying to come back into ministry. And Pastor Philip asked this pastor, I said, well, what are they going to do when he comes back in ministry? He said, well, he'll have to start on the bottom and work up. He said, oh, good, that means I get a promotion because I'm at the bottom. People hunting promotion, waiting on promotion. Neither has the Lord chosen this. You've got to be willing to be the servant. And this is where I'm ending up at. Now, let me tell you something. I told my wife, I said, you know, for years, I thought successful past preaching and pastoring was preaching people up on their feet and I love that. Oh, I love that, and I can do that. But I found out something. If it don't do you any good when you walk out that door, it's a sounding brass and a clanging cymbal. I'd rather preach something to keep you walking straight out there than jumping up on your feet in here. I'm not a cheerleader. I'm not a rah-rah, sis-bamboo. No. I am your shepherd and your pastor, and I got something to give you right now. God's not looking for the talented or the beautiful. He's looking for the servant. Blessed is that servant whom when the master comes, finds him about the father's business. None of those sons who were sitting up in daddy's house waiting to be discovered, none of them were anointed. It was the boy out there with the sheep. Not the ones that, I got to get a church today. I need a blessing. I need a blessing. I need a blessing. You're not getting anointed to kill giants. Oh, I got to get mine. I got to get mine. I got to get mine. God's not going to anoint you to kill giants. He's looking for the faithful one willing to take care of some sheep. Peter, do you love me? You know I love you. Take care of my sheep. Peter, do you really love me? You know I love you. Take care of my sheep. Three times, feed my sheep. Do you love God? It's not necessarily demonstrated by how high you jump and how loud you holler up in here. Feed my sheep. Get busy doing something besides your own thing. Is this okay today? The elder son, look at this, and I'm getting ready to close. Go ahead and get ready, guys. The elder son made a powerful statement in Luke chapter 15, verse 29, talking about the prodigal son again. He told his father, all these years I have been serving you. All these years I've been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, yet you never gave me as much as a young goat and make merry with my friends. What did the older son say? He was the same as the younger son. He got a greater portion. But he said, Daddy, I've been serving. Somebody say serving. See, a lot of us have that give me, give me. We come to church with that. Lord bless me, Lord bless me, Lord bless me, Lord bless me. We're like the younger son. And what happens is we get all of our blessing, and then we go out there and we fall prey to the first famine that comes along. And before we can get back to the Father's house, we're hungry, we're destitute. But he said to the older son, you stayed, you fought the fight, you stood the test. Everything I have is yours. Well, wouldn't you love to hear God say that? Everything I have is yours. You need healing? You don't have to ask me for healing. Everything that I have is yours. You need a miracle? You don't wait for me to give you a miracle. Just say to this mountain, be thou removed, and it'll be done so. If you're faithful in being that servant, everything that I have is yours. Just say to this mountain. Is that good preaching? He came to anoint the boy. He said, is there not any more sons? Well, there remains the youngest. And behold, he's tending the sheep. The difference in us all facing our giants and our defeating our giants is, are you willing to be faithful with the sheep? Go ahead and stand on your feet. Remember what Eliab told him? Eliab said, David, I know what you're doing. You just came out here to see the battle. And who did you leave those few little sheep with? You know what? It may be a very few little sheep. Feed my sheep. Look out for somebody else. Pray for somebody else. Minister to somebody else. Take somebody like we had this family who lost a husband, father, father-in-law. Take time to get on the phone and call them and tell them, I'm praying for you. I love you. Find somebody in your job, on your neighborhood. Find some sheep that need some caring. That's who God's looking for, to kill some giants. Some people that are not so obsessed with their own life and so full of their own importance, they're sitting around waiting on theirs. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the promise of the supernatural this year. Giants are coming down. Walls are coming down. Miracles are about to take place and transpire in this body. And I thank you, Lord. God, we just glorify your name and magnify you and lift you up and bless you. We give you praise. Let's just sing a little bit more of that, how great is our God. Can we do that a little bit more? I just want to glorify him a little more in this house. We'll sing that and I'm going to let you go. But let's sing that a little bit more. How great is our God? All will see how great. Come on, sing it to him.
How great
is
our God?
Come on, sing it to him. We sing it to you, Lord.
How great is our God?
We'll see.
One more time,
sing it, yeah. life you do. Before you go out of this building today, I want you to go love on somebody, share a good word with somebody, encourage somebody, but don't let it stop inside this building. Walk out of this place doing the same thing. God bless you. I love you. Have a great day. Great week.
Yeah.